Now we'll start the last presentation in this session, entitled Hierarchical Correlation Reconstruction Between Statistical and Machine Learning. And it will be presented by Jarosław Duda.
Okay, thank you very much. Yesterday I was told that there are missing speakers, and yesterday it turned out that I will also give this second talk. So it's very different than the previous one. So now it's what I'm working on in data analysis. So these are methods between classical statistics and machine learning. So this is kind of high parameter copula like models. So in classical statistics, we have a low number of parameters. So this is relatively rough description of data. But there are many advantages, like we have these moments. We can understand the interpretability. They are independently estimated usually. They have unique values. We have control accuracy, but we don't have the density. Getting the density is a difficult problem, and you later don't have complete description of the joint density. In machine learning, we have quite the opposite. We have huge models usually, but with very, very poor interpretability, trained by iteration. So we don't have understanding of the parameters often. We don't have interpretability of these parameters. So I'm talking about kind of intermediate models, which also operate on moments, mixed moments. But this time chosen such that we can reconstruct the joint distribution. So from these kind of moments, we will be able to get the model of distribution in one dimension, of joint distribution in multiple dimensions, up to complete description of joint distribution. So it kind of combines the advantages. So we can have very high parameter models with very good understanding. So the model is just the density as linear combination. In this case, using orthonormal basis for these linear combinations, the estimation is extremely simple and cheap. It's just so that this parameter for a function f is just mean of the data set of given function from our orthonormal basis. So it is very convenient to normalize the variables to nearly uniform the densities of each variable. So having two variables, if there are no dependencies after such normalization, like in copulative theory, there would be uniform distribution on the square. So it would be rho equal one on the square, but usually there are some dependencies, and we describe them as this series of coefficients in orthonormal basis. So this is orthonormal basis of polynomials presented with the density. And the first coefficients is kind of similar to correlation coefficient. So you can see that it has increased density in this one edge and the second vertex. So we can see that if this is large, then growing with one variable, the second variable grows with expected value. And then you have, so this kind of correlation coefficient, but we have also higher moments, mixed moment between the two variables. So this is between first moment of the first variable and second moment of the second variable. So if it is positive, then growing with first variable, then there grows variance of the second variable. Yes. So this is dependence between first variable and first moment of the first variable and second moment of the second variable. And this is the opposite. And this is dependence between the second moment. So if one variable has large variance, then the second variable is also large variance. So this is also similar to homoscedasticity in economy. So we get this kind of decomposition of joint density in orthonormal basis. Okay, so here is some simple example in one dimension. So we have some points, the orange points, 100 points, and you'd like to model the density with a polynomial. Degree zero polynomial is just a constant, the D1 only has kind of expected value. Degree two also has also variance, skewness, and so on. We could get as high number as we would like. So we can have very high parameter models. However, there is this overfitting them that using too many, we have some artifacts. So there is a difficult question how to choose the basis. So this is this estimation, but let me skip this. I have not enough time. So here is such example. So we have some points, the black points. So we know that the density projecting on one or the second variable should be nearly uniform. So this normalization as for copula, but we can see that there are some dependencies. So here we model the dependencies with these four functions as shown here. So here we have four parameter model of the joint density for the two variables. So you can see that there is some increased density at the center and this diagonal and here. Here is analogously, but using up to ninth moment. So this is like 81, I think. 81 such coefficients. So we can describe the joint density. These are very, very cheap models to estimate, and we have the model of joint density as a polynomial. So for example, so here are some economical view that having some 29 Dow Jones companies and looking at this daily change. So looking at the correlation matrix, it looks like this. And looking at this 1-1 coefficients I have mentioned, this between the first moments, we get very similar dependence. But you have also additional dependencies. So here is dependence between first moment of the one variable and second moment of the second variable. So this is no longer a symmetric statistical dependence. So for example, we could try to imply some direction of causality thanks of this kind of asymmetric statistical dependencies. We can also have some time evolution of these coefficients for non-stationarity. We can also have this homoscedasty that with high variance of one variable, there is also high variance of the second variable. So we need to normalize the variables first. So for which I usually use some parametric distribution. So there are these generalized normal distribution. So for beta equal 2, it's Gaussian. Beta equal 1 is Laplace distribution. But we can also have different powers, all some heavy tails distribution like student now recently, stable distributions. Okay, so there is also, we can also add some adaptivity that the width of this Laplace or Gaussian distribution can evolve in time, but I let me not get into the details. So for example, so we have some data from these stocks of various companies, and we can look at what is the optimal kappa. So usually economic people assume Gaussian distribution kappa equal 2, but doing the estimation usually get much lower, below 1. So not 2 for Gaussian, but later even lower than Laplace distribution. So it's general lesson that we should be careful with Gaussian distributions, because in real data it is often not Gaussian distribution. And then using it for normalization by this kind of formula, then we can use at pairs, for example, yesterday price and today price, and having the yesterday day price, we can substitute this value yesterday, and we get the conditional distribution for today. Yes, so knowing that yesterday we can substitute, and we have density for today. So we can predict conditional distribution based on some context like previous day value. So here are these kind of predictions that we first predict the density for such normalized variable as here the degree 2 polynomial, and then we need to calibrate it to make it non-negative. So modeling density as polynomial, it can get below 0, so we need to use some function like maximum with some value to get it to non-zero, and then we can go back to this normalization function and finally getting this kind of final conditional distribution. So the gray line is the marginal distribution without prediction, and the colorful are predicted conditional distributions, which are kind of deformed marginal distribution. Okay, so we can also do it. So I've shown two-dimensional situation. You can also do it for higher dimensional situation in very automatic way. So this is where the name comes from, that we have hierarchical decomposition of dependencies into moments of single variables, then into mixed moments of pairs of variables, then of mixed moment of triples of variables, and so on. So we can kind of hierarchically reconstruct dependencies between various numbers of variables and build joint distribution model based on such dependencies. For example, so for three variables, we have just, we get again this basis of product basis of polynomials for like here. And the estimation is like previously just us taking average of function of given function. So this is extremely cheap. And we get this mixed moment. So the function with zero index is its identity. So if there is zero, there is no dependence. So we have many variables like 15 here and many zeros. So that means that there is no dependence of this variable. But then we have two here and two here. That means that these coefficients correspond to dependence between second moment of this variable and second moment of this variable. So this is, we can reconstruct this dependency of many variables into this pairwise, triplewise, and so on statistical dependencies. So we can, so here is estimation as value. We could also make this this adaptive estimation that these moments evolve in time. So by just replacing this averaging with some, for example, exponential moving average. So we can very cheaply have also time evolving joint distribution model. Okay, so we can, for example, use it for missing data. So for example, here is the green line is the sample. So knowing that this one variable is this one. So standard missing data would say that we should expect value in the middle, but we see that we shouldn't expect value in the middle because we should expect this green value or this green value. So the density would be modal here. Yes. So and this kind of model can predict such more complex like bimodal distributions. So here is some comparison with this kind of density estimation standard model. So we have these points like here, and the question is what is the joint density? So here are some, here is the using the polynomial model using degree 1, 2, 3 up to 6 polynomial. And here is KDE. So in KDE, density estimation, you put a Gaussian in every point and add these Gaussians here. We get the joint density. So the question is, what is the radius of this Gaussian? So here are the radius, this epsilon is radius of the Gaussian. So now we would like to compare them. So we should compare them in look like good usually for model of densities in cross-validation. So we have a random subset for the training of the model, and then the remaining for the testing of log likelihood. So here is the green one for this data is MLA maximum likelihood for this kernel density estimation. So zero is just assuming rho equal one. So without prediction we get zero. So we can see that this model barely gets above zero. While the models with polynomials or trigonometric function can get some positive, really positive likelihood. So it's much better than kind of density estimation. So this is the best one here, model. So in cross validation. So based on the training data, what is the estimation on the test data? So usually this kind of density estimation is good for one dimension. For two dimensions, we can see that there is very, so it's overfits. So it assumes that new data will be in the previous values, but it's usually not true. And this model indeed tries to generalize, to find some more general features like moments. Yes. So it's much better than the KDE, especially in high dimensions. Okay, so let me skip it. It is kind of high parameter copula model. So copula models are popular in economics. So they also normalize the marginal distributions and then try to choose one of families of copulas, and they are usually low parametric families, like one or two parameters. And usually it works for two dimensions. In high dimension, you need, there are some trees, like wine copulas, but it's very complicated and it's low parametric still. While here we can use as many parameters as we need. So we just take cross validation, and choose the number of parameters that which moments we should use to maximize likelihood in cross-validation, for example. So it is automatic and usually much more accurate than the computer model or density estimation models. Okay, so here is some examples of prediction of some spread in of some financial spread. So let me only say so here is the real spread, and here so on this vertical axis there is a real value normalized, and on horizontal is the predicted value. So it, perfect predictor would have diagonal. So here you can see that it's nearly diagonal, but here you have just noise. So these are standard methods. They just give noise for this spread prediction. Why the models I'm talking about? So they predict the entire conditional density, and we can take the expected value and treat it as predicted value. So we can see that they are able, for this very difficult task, they are able to give some reasonable predictors. But generally, so there is this advantage of predicting the entire density. So usually also in machine learning, you are focused on predicting just values. But in practice, in mathematics, we cannot predict values, continuous values, because we have just probability distribution instead. So this is different philosophy of going from value prediction into prediction of entire conditional probability distribution. So the advantage of predicting entire probability distribution is that you have also uncertainty. We know how good our prediction is. We have value, we have moments, we can find quantiles. You can perform Monte Carlo with such model of conditional density. And then usually there are some further non-linear function, and we should use the conditional distribution, not just the expected value. But there are many advantages from going from just predicting value to predicting entire probability distribution. Okay, so maybe let's skip it and go to some nice examples. So here is some example. From value from GUS, from this statistics institute in Poland, about some household income. So there are like 30 variables, and you would like to predict conditional distribution for income of a person, for example, to predict the credibility evaluation. So somebody has a tax field, and they would like to predict how this tax is credible. Yes. So for example, here is the edge of the age of the head of the family, and here is this income per number of persons in the family. So what we can see that the persons younger has this distribution a bit toward right. Persons middle-aged persons go toward left, so lower, and finally the other person closer to center. So if the older person would say that he has extreme income, both large and small, then the credibility drops, is smaller. So finally, we have like 30 variables which are both continuous and discrete. Like here are the four continuous, and we predict this polynomial for density. We go to this calibration to have non-negative densities, and then we can go back to this through the normalization to the original variable to have the, and then we can check if the income in the tax declaration is in low or high probability region. If it's in high, then the tax is credible. Otherwise, it can be less credible. Yes. So the model it looks like that. So that we predict. So we like to predict this one variable, continuous variable. So we split this prediction into four just linear regression, but four linear regression. So one linear regression is kind of for expected value. So with number of persons in the family, with higher number of persons, the expected value drops of this income. But we also predict the variance. So we can see that, for example, for education, for higher education increases the expected value of income, but also increases the variance of income, because it can be in philosophy or in computer science, for example. Yes, so we get many linear regressions, and each such value have interpretation. How given feature influences first moment predicted, second moment, third, and so on. And then having such predicted four moments, we get them together into one polynomial and translate them into conditional distribution predicted. So this is just extending linear regression into predicting the entire conditional probability distributions. Okay, so we can, for example, evaluate these kind of features. We can do a lot of that. So another example is for some astrophysics data. So I got the data. This is in collaboration with astrophysicists. So this is some blazar data. So the active cores of a galaxy. So this, every week they have one value. So this is for 10 years data. So this is about 500 points per this astronomical object. So each of them is one object. So again, we can normalize the values. After normalizations, we have the brown points. And then we here I model evolving density. So I have mentioned that the estimation of the parameters is just mean over the sample of the function. And we can replace this mean with exponential moving average. So the previous coefficient is updated with the new values, and we get the new coefficient. So we get evolving polynomial as the density evaluation, and the grayness is this evolving polynomial. So we can see that the predicted density evolves in time. So we can evaluate the non-stationarity here. So for example, how large this eta should be chosen. So how fast should we forget about the past? So this is one evaluation of this non-stationarity. Also, how well this function localizes. So here it localizes well. Here it localizes weakly. So we get kind of two features describing non-stationarity of these sources. So then also it turned out that these sources are not just log normal as usual it is chosen. It turns out that some of them are related heavy tapes. So looking at log likelihood based on the alpha parameter in stable distribution, usually 2 is the maximum likelihood. That means that it's indeed normal distribution, but sometimes it's much lower. So here we can see that instead of 2, we get heavy tails like 1.6. So 1 is Cauchy distribution, 2 is Gaussian. So clearly these objects have heavy tails, and it was not known in the literature. Okay, so it was non-stationarity evaluation, and now there is multi-feature autocorrelation analysis. So here we have some these values in various lags. So that means that, I have problem seeing the top. Maybe, okay. So here we have the pairs of values shifted by lag 15. So here is value in time t, and here is value in time t plus 15. So here is for 15, 30, and so on up to 90. So we can see that there is some autocorrelation. Yes. So the question is how to describe this autocorrelation. So usually there is just use correlation or covariance function, but it only describes dependence between the first moments. And here we can, again, so we can look at these points and model the density with this series of moments. So we get this moment of density for these points, and so on. And so for each moment, we have some dependence of the lag. So here is the lag. So here was 15. 13, so here is the lag in the horizontal axis, and so on. So we had not just one autocorrelation function, but multiple autocorrelation functions. And each of them has own interpretation. So it interpretation of this one is this contribution of should be multiplied by this function to the joint density. So we can also perform some dimensionality reduction and get some characteristic function, and we get better understanding of autocorrelation. Which are much more complicated than just autocorrelation function. We have many features describing autocorrelation, and for the end, this kind of analysis also we can perform for some economical data. So usually that is used, for example, DCC as this dynamical conditional correlation. So this is correlation evolving in time for between multiple index financial indexes. And so instead of this one coefficient, we can perform multiple features, which describe various types of changes of correlations, which is called contagion. That there is some contagion between financial markets. So, for example, here is some important events, and the question is if this contagion evaluation features are seeing these events, and turns out that if using multiple features, we can better see that something is changing in the market, and you can better describe it and try to find some various types of events. Okay, and finally, it would be great to try to build some neural networks based on this kind of model that each neuron tries to build, update model of joint distribution of connected neurons and try to propagate, for example, conditional distributions from that. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Do you have any questions? Comments? I have one, maybe one. In case of your methods, you can calculate correlation, but you will use the only this correlation, or you will multiply this value or change. Which process is? Could you explain this process of?
Okay, so here is, for example, autocorrelation. So we have time series and look at values shifted by some lag 15. So here are all pairs shifted by lag 15, 30, and so on. So here are all the pairs. So we can see that there is some dependence. They are not exactly independent. So we would like to describe this dependence not just by one single value of correlation, but with multiple values. So one describes this correlation. The second describes dependence between first moment of the first variable and second moment of the second variable, and so on. So we have for many mixed moments, we find the dependence for them. So getting this kind of, so each one, this is the lag, and this is various type of moments. So this is the standard moment, and here is this homoscedasticity, as economists would call it. And then there is performed the dimensionality reduction, PCA here, and we finally get the most important features. So toward this feature, there is the largest variability of this joint distribution. So the joint distribution mostly changes in this direction, and you can describe this change, and you can see some periods, but also it changes in this direction. You can see some periods again. So this is multiple feature autocorrelation analysis that we don't just ask for correlation, but also for higher mixed moment, and we get the dependence between them. We can have interpretability for these features.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but for example, you will calculate the coefficient for the first basis or hierarchical function. I don't know what is your nomenclature. And after that for the second, and could you return to the previous one, to the first one?
So they are independently chosen. So this basis is orthonormal. The estimation of each
okay. Independent. Okay, orthonormal, but in case of the data, so my question is, you will calculate the first coefficient for the first term, after that for the second term, and so on, and in your algorithm, you will go back to, can you go back to the first term and recalculate or no?
So here is one such function. So here is lag. So the pairs are shifted by 20, by 40, by 60, and so on. And for this kind of pairs, we calculate the first coefficient, and the same for the second coefficient, and so on. So I had, like, using moments up to four, I had 16 series like dependencies.
Okay.
Not one like from standard correlation, but about 16, for example. And then I perform this dimensionality reduction to get some more appropriate basis in which the change is the largest.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. Any questions, comments? No,
thank you. You mentioned about neural networks. Sure. What architecture of neural networks are you going to use?
So what I wanted to do is that usually neurons want to predict values, but what I would like to do is that neurons predict conditional distributions. So for example, a neuron updates its model of joint distribution of neighboring neurons, and then based on the input values, it predicts the conditional distribution for the missing for the inputs which are not used, and it can be this kind of models that it continuously updates model of joint distribution of neighboring neurons and try to predict conditional distributions for the missing, for example, values. So okay, these are
So is it feed-forward architecture?
I don't know. So it can be various architectures, but this is the way of thinking. So non-linearity is in this function which are polynomials, and then it can predict the entire conditional distributions, not just values. So it has a bit different. So it can be various.
Probably it can be also a recurrent neural network.
Sure. Yes. So this is just the idea for neuron, which has model of joint distribution and predicts the conditional distributions. Yes.
All right. Thank you.
Any questions? Okay. So thank you very much for the talk. And now we'll have the break, and we'll start at.